CEO Sri Ajay Bhushan Pandey, Secretary Expenditure Sri Girish Chandra Murmu, Secretary Deepam Sri Anil Kachi, and Special Secretary DGFT Sri Alok Vardhan Chaturvedi. I extend a warm welcome to all the honorable dignitaries. Friends, the format of the conference will be as follows, as in the past actually. At the outset, the Finance Minister will make a presentation, following which there will be a question answer session. While asking your questions, please identify yourself and your organization. Please organize your thoughts and ask questions, direct questions, instead of going doing it in a roundabout way, so that we can cover as many correspondents as possible. Looking forward to your cooperation. Now over to you, ma'am, for the presentation.
Thank you. Once again, as was promised earlier, we've come before you to announce some measures which are being periodically formulated based on the inputs that we've obtained during the nationwide consultations that we are doing. So they seem to come in tranches rather than at one go. So, but each time we are making a clear attempt to also connect with the previous announcements that we made. Also give you a small view, a cameo picture, if I may say so, of all that which has been followed up since after the last announcements. So we made last two announcements. I can broadly give you a picture of where they stand and how many are being followed up. So in my today's presentation, as always, I'll just give you a brief picture of what I'm presenting before you. I want to start with a very brief picture of the macroeconomic fundamentals that we have now before us, and also say if there are any signs of revival from some sectors, then move over to say about the measures which are being followed up since after the last two announcements, and then commence by saying the tax-related, essentially implementation of taxation-related measures, just so this issue of getting technology into tax assessments, steps taken so that the sense that tax authorities are overreaching is clearly wiped out of the minds, because we have made quite a lot of concrete steps in that direction. So I'll give a couple of slides on that and then move over to talking about what we want to do for the exports of this country. Today we'll be focusing on the exports, and then the second is on the home buyers. So today's flow would be, one, I'm talking about the macroeconomic fundamentals, then looking at where the revival signs are in particular segments, then looking at the tax-related reform measures, then fourth, go over to the two segments that we are addressing with some kind of input coming from the government, one of exports at large and also of the home buyers. So if I go through that, you got before you on the slide there as to what is the position on the consumer price index, the inflation particularly, which has been kept very much below and under control. So technically you would know between 2.5 to 3 to about 4 is the bandwidth which all of us are normally considered safe, because we've kept a top limit of 4. But between 3 and 6 would be any time better. But even then, the inflation has always been held well before under 4. So one of the very strong indicator for an economy is the level to which the inflation has been held. So that is the first slide. And the second one also tells you about the flow with which it went. Moving over to the industrial production, in spite of all the worries that industrial production indicators showed in the fourth quarter of 18-19, because it reached a level which was fairly concerning most of us, we see a clear sign of revival in the first quarter of 19-20, and on the second quarter, not really the second quarter, but up to July end. So that straight arrow explains that the revival signs are very, very consistent. Then that is also shown in the core industries. The July figures, which were released only a couple of days ago, probably would explain that. The revival of fixed investment is also very clearly showing a positive picture. Between 17-18 and 18-19, if you compare year on year, the annual fixed investment rate as a percentage of GDP, you can see the bar chart there, and also for the quarter-wise fixed investment rate is going upwards, and you can see that it is in the first quarter, 19-20, shown a clear, distinct, positive upward growth. Then we move over to the fiscal deficit and contained CAD. The fiscal deficit to GDP ratio, which was well known from the time the July budget was presented, and we've kept up the figures. The current account deficit, of course, shows a bit of a hike in 18-19, but that is the background for one of the indicators of the macroeconomic factors. Then you go over to the FDI flows, on which there has been a lot of discussion. We can very clearly see that the numbers between, if you compare between 14-15 going upward, 15-16, 16-17 and so on, you can see between 18-19 and 19-20, as of now, there is a clear sign of revival. And the reserves, of course, particularly at August end, has really gone up, as a result of which we have one of the best reserve, level of reserve, which is being maintained now. I'll quickly move over, as I said earlier, on what are the kind of follow-up we've made on the announcements that we've made twice before. Announcements were made on 23rd August and again on the 30th of August regarding series of measures that we took. I had reported implementation of 6 of the 32 announcements relating to, relating essentially to banking. That was on 23rd August. The partial credit guarantee scheme for banks to buy assets of NBFCs has been implemented. There are several NBFCs who have already benefited. We'll be probably giving you a more detailed picture as we go along. Not if not today, some other time, but the NBFCs are really receiving the benefits of that partial credit guarantee scheme that was announced. Then there is definitely an increased and improved credit outflows from banks. The transmission of interest rate cuts are being affected by banks also. Just for your information, at this stage, I would like to tell you that on 19th of September, a day before the GST Council's meeting, I shall be meeting with all the PSB heads and talking to them in detail about how the credit flow system is going on, post our announcing partial credit guarantee scheme, and post our infusing more money into the banks. So on the 19th, specifically for this particular agenda, I shall be meeting up with the chiefs of the public sector banks. Then this is where I start telling you all about the infusion of more technology towards better assessment process, where human interface will be cut down to the bare minimum. So the notification for the e-assessment scheme, which I had earlier announced, saying it will be implemented from Vijayadashmi Day, has already been notified. So on 12/9/2019, the e-assessment scheme has already been notified. And the main features of it are something which I would want you to please listen to with intent. Removal of existing human interface in the assessment procedure will be the first feature. Total removal of human interface. Assessment to be handled by specific functional units on the basis of automated allocation system. The allocation will happen completely automated by the big data management team, so there is no human discretion element into that. Assessment unit will also be anonymous. All communication to be made exclusively in the electronic mode only, and no personal appearance of any SSC at all. So with this major one step forward, we feel any element of discretion leading to harassment will all be removed. and we will give good attention to its effective implementation. This was something which was already announced, the document identification number. The particular point which was, the order was issued as of 14th August, but with 1 month of implementation, we are able to say that this is really taking off, in that all notices, summons and orders, communication to be issued only through the system. So there is no one-to-one personally handing out a kind of notice. It will be through the system generated with a particular document identification number. All documents to have unique DIN. Validation of documents issued can be done on e-filing portal only. Documents without DIN can be treated as non-est, meaning in law it won't hold any good. This was announced, much was spoken about it. I'm not saying this is new, but I'm definitely saying post the notification in August, we have seen a month full of this happening. There's already a lot of people who are receiving this, and there is a certain element of recognizing discretion will now be out. Then the nomenclature which was given, I do not know from where, but Sabka Vishwas, the compounding of all past offences, which was partly announced in the budget, the circular has been issued as of 9th of September. What does this imply? It implies that all compounding application can be filed up to 31st December 2019, which were not filed within prescribed time schedule earlier. So anyone who wishes to have their application given can still give it till December, and there is a clear formatted tick box method of clearing all the past offences and settling for a pre-decided levels of penalty. Again, no discretion here. This will reduce the existing pendency of prosecution cases before the courts. So this settlement will remove the need for people to go to the courts to seek redressal. Follow-up action again on prosecution easing measures. Again, a circular has been issued on the 9th of September, and this will have these following features. Smaller taxpayers with minor procedural defaults will not be prosecuted. We had mentioned this, but the notification and the circular has come out on the 9th of September. Prosecution to be launched only in deserving cases and to be commensurate to the degree of offence. So this fear of everybody is being prosecuted, criminal action is being taken, is now completely removed. Where it is possible, particularly for small taxpayer, procedurally small errors, technical errors, will now be seen as smaller offences which need not go through the route of prosecution. For defaults below 25 lakhs, prosecution shall be sanctioned only with the prior approval of a collegium of two CCIT or DGIT rank officers. So it's not going to be automatically somebody decides to take action, he takes action. Now the collegium will have to give an approval. It will consist of two people, top level officials. Now I go to the two main focus area of today, the exports, boosting of exports, and measures that we want to take in order to boost exports. This might need a bit of narration, but steps which have been taken so far, so that you understand the background with which the newer steps which are coming, so that the whole measures that have been taken this far will become far more effective. You see that the interest equalization scheme had existed between from 2015, and some kind of an interest equalization to the level of 3% to exporters, and particularly for about 416 lines and for all the MSMEs were given. And this had continued from 2015. Then the IEA's rate, interest equalization scheme rate was increased to 5% for MSME exporters with effect from 18th November 2018, and merchant exporters were also covered under the scheme with effect from 2nd February this year, 2019. So these are the steps which had already been taken up. Then you also understand the ease of doing business ranking were changed. We improved on it. Trade infrastructure for the export scheme, the TIE scheme, were also being very clearly followed. agricultural export policy was announced, enabling products which come from agriculture also to find an export market. Then transport and marketing assistance, which was given, was also taken up from 5th of March. Schemes for the rebate, which is the ROSCTL, had obtained cabinet approval for the garments and particular segments within the textiles. These were the broad background of actions which had been taken till now in the last 2 years, ending till February of 19. But now what we want to do is, I will probably be putting the new measures in about 6 silos, which all relate to exports. So under boosting, under measures for boosting exports, I'm coming up with 6 different silos. The first one is the scheme for remission of duties on taxes on export products will replace MEIS. Now, I'd like to draw your attention that the name alone has not changed. It is not ROSCTL. It is not ROSL. It is remission of duties, RODTEP, remission of duties or taxes on export products. This is a new scheme which is coming, and it shall replace, completely replace MEIS. Completely replace MEIS, not just for textiles, but for all goods and services for which the goods particularly, for which the coverage was given both by the Textile Ministry and the Commerce Ministry. So this one will replace all MEIS. Existing dispensation in textiles of MEIS and the, plus the old ROSL will continue up to December 31st, 2019. I wish this particular line is made absolutely clear. The existing dispensation in textiles, which is MEIS plus old ROSL, will continue up to December 31st, 2019. This is so because a lot of exporters probably have taken orders and they will have to be given a lead time, so we are giving this lead time. However, it equally means that post 31st December 2019, no MEIS will continue. It will only be remission of duties or taxes on export product, and that will completely replace all MEIS from 1st January 2020. So MEIS, I repeat, MEIS, particularly in the textile dispensation, MEIS plus old ROSL will continue only up to 31st December 2019. Now, textiles and all other sectors which currently enjoy incentives up to 2% over MEIS, which is already existing MEIS, over that you had 2%, will transit into RODTEP from January 1st, 2020. In effect, this new one, the RODTEP, will more than adequately incentivize exporters than the existing schemes all put together. So if we are wondering what this new scheme will do, will it be more or will it be less? Here am I making a clear statement that in effect, the RODTEP, the new scheme which comes into effect from 1st January 2020 for textiles and for all other commerce-related products, will more than adequately incentivize exporters than the existing schemes all put together. Revenue foregone, projected, is up to 50,000 crores. So that is the number which I want you to look at. Approximately, we are saying up to 50,000 crores will be growing through this new RODTEP. So that's my first silo for promotion of exports, particularly for those which are going through from textiles and commerce. Very clearly, labor-intensive sectors will get priority. The next silo in boosting exports, the measures that I want to mention here, are fully electronic refund module for quick and automated refund of ITC, that is the input tax credits, nearing completion and will be implemented by the end of this month itself. So by September 2019, the fully electronic refund mechanism for the GST ITC refunds will be in place. This is expected to monitor and also to speed up all ITC refunds. So there shouldn't be lockup of funds disturbing the credit cash flow for all the small and medium exporters, and therefore refunds on your input tax should be automated and speedy. The third silo in the measures to boost exports is about export finance. This is very important, and I understand post the Board of Trade meeting, the DGFT is here, post the Board of Trade meeting which was held a day or two ago, an indication has been given that this is under consideration. I'm glad to announce, and I thank the Commerce Ministry for having put in a lot of effort to get this through. The Export Credit Guarantee Corporation, the ECGC, will expand the scope of ECIS and will offer higher insurance cover. Here I would want to just make sure that some of the numbers can be understood. Higher insurance cover to banks lending working capital for exports. Premium incidence for MSME will be moderated suitably, which is when MSME pay their premium towards guarantee that they receive from the ECGC, the premium that they pay will now be far lesser than what they had paid earlier. It is expected that the initiative will cost about 1,700 crores per annum for the government, but that will be the kind of support we are extending for the ECGC to offer that kind of guarantee for exporters. At the moment, for US dollar-based lending, whatever the prevailing rate be, this might come down by about 4% is our calculation, but I'm giving you a rough picture. And for the rupee, it will be coming down by about 8%. So that is the kind of difference it will make because of this facility that we are extending through the ECGC, and therefore the burden on exporters, particularly when they borrow and take credit and do their business, the burden shall come down. The credit insurance scheme, export credit insurance scheme, will benefit because of this extension of 1,700 crore per annum from the government for the promotion of credit guarantee by the ECGC. So this will enable reduction in the overall cost of export credit, including interest rates, especially to the MSMEs. The next silo is on the priority sector lending norms for export credit. These have been examined and enabling guidelines are under consideration with the RBI. We have had extensive discussion with the Reserve Bank of India on this, and they are on board. I am sure sooner they will also be able to release the necessary notification for this. This will release an additional 36,000 crores to up to 68,000 crores as export credit under priority sector, because banks use this in their basket of lending portfolios. When the priority sector lending category comes, with this additional infusion, priority sector lending for export credit will increase, and this will give greater impetus for export sector. Then the next silo under measures to boost exports is the data on export finance is regularly published by the RBI. However, now export finance will be actively monitored by an interministerial working group, so that there is, hopefully, if this is going to immediately make a big difference, this might even look at it on a weekly basis. So interministerial working group is being formed, which will monitor export finance actively, and that will be located in the Department of Commerce. The Department of Commerce will run it, and it will also be tracked through a dashboard, reviewed with institutions, and also with active intervention being carried out where necessary. So the interministerial group will do a weekly monitoring. Export finance will be continuously checked, and also making sure the dashboard is available for everyone to see as to where the money is going and where it is getting clogged up, so that we can help remove any congestion. The next silo on export facilitation is leverage technology to reduce time to export or turnaround time. This is a very important step forward. Technology is further being used so that the initial time which is being taken the time to export that is being taken at each of the ports will come down. For an example, I was just when we were discussing, ports like Boston take 0.55 days only for a turnaround, which is less than half a day. Shanghai takes about 0.83 days, whereas best of India, which is Kochi, takes 1.10 days. Now, we are using technology to make sure all the clearances which are required at every port and also custom related, and elimination of all offline material, manual services will all be removed, so that quickly our turnaround time at the ports will also reach the global best. So this is a major initiative which we want to push through in this time, so that the best of performance can help in more faster clearances at the ports. An action plan to reduce time to export or the turnaround time in airports and ports benchmarked to the international standards, which is what I read out to you with the examples of Boston and Shanghai, will also be taken up, and it will be completely implemented by December 2019, which is in another 3 months' time, maximum of 2.5 months' time. Actual turnaround time will be published in real time for everyone to see, for each port and airport to push them to improve performance. So that's going to be available for you and me to see, and we can always monitor so that there's a greater sense of competition among ports. An interministerial group again will be made accountable for this. So it's not as if we've directed people, we are just waiting for them to implement it. We shall be monitoring it through an interministerial group. And the last but a very populist and attractive option is India shall hold annual mega shopping festivals, like the way you hear in Dubai, in an organized large-scale basis and across the country in 4 different destinations. By March 2020, it should happen. The themes shall vary. There shall be gems and jewelry, handicrafts, yoga, tourism, textiles and leather, so that there is a greater push and promotion, a global thrust for immediately for people to come and see and make their connections, make their contacts for large-scale purchases or for instantly having ideas of connection between manufacturers and sellers. So this mega shopping festivals will enthuse all these small and medium manufacturers of our handicrafts and also who are linked with tourism to benefit from. So in order to boost exports, these are some of the main steps. The fifth silo in my case is the free trade agreements. We'd like to clearly indicate to you and through you the special FTA agreements that FTA agreement utilization mission that we want to launch. What does that indicate? We have several FTAs, and the sense whenever we interact with the industry or exporters is that they don't seem to optimally utilize the existing FTAs, leading to periodically, even you from the media have asked us, are you reviewing the FTAs? Here what we are telling you is, for an effective utilization of the FTAs, which already are with us, a senior officer from the Department of Commerce will be set up to monitor an FTA utilization mission. What would he or she do? To work exclusively with the Federation of Export Organization and with the export houses you know, there are nearly 32 export-related associations, federations, which are partly associated with the Commerce Ministry. All of them will be given a clear introduction to how to use all the concessional tariffs that exist in each of the FTA. For want of use, for want of maximum utilization of the concessional tariff which is already built in each of the FTAs, we find that many of the exporters are at a loss. Whereas when we find the other end of the FTA utilizing the features which are given, they tend to better benefit from the Indian markets, whereas our exporters, for want of link or want of awareness or want of understanding the nuance which prevails in the FTA, don't benefit so much. So this mission, with the senior officer heading it, will immediately spend a lot of time looking at how to maximum utilize the concessional tariffs which are built in FTAs, enhance awareness of preferential duty, which is another area where we find many of our exporters are not really optimally benefiting from. So the preferential duty benefits which exist will have to be now widely spread among the MSMEs. So the dissemination of this information and facilitation so that compliance requirements such as the rules of origin, certificate of origin, can all be much more streamlined, methodically used, and the exporters are not left to fend for themselves. And this will be available for the importers and exporters. And the set goals for FTA utilization are also put in place so that effective FTA monitoring system can be run. So this will come into play immediately so that any MSME, any exporter who wants to benefit from greater information can utilize the service. The other matter is on the origin management system. We find that most often, under the rules of origin, most of our exporters suffer. For exporters to enable them to obtain certificate of origin, there will be an origin management system which will be launched in the next few weeks by the DGFT. I'm glad that DGFT is here. If you have any questions, he can also answer. And this will be in collaboration with export inspection councils because they play a very critical role in this. So the DGFT together with the Export Inspection Council will activate this. This is expected to significantly improve ease of doing business for the exporters. So that's about the free trade agreement. And the fifth silo, the last but one at the, for the export measures, time-bound adoption of mandatory technical standards. This is an area which I'd like to highlight to all of you all. There shall be time-bound adoption by industry of all necessary mandatory technical standards and their effective enforcement to elevate the quality and performance of the ecosystem, enhance competitiveness, and address the issue of substandard imports. I'm sure all of you are aware, I need not underline the importance of this particular measure. Whilst it's important for quality determination of our export products, most often the imports which come in and the quality of the imports, the standards that they stand up to, are matters of great concern. So now it is very clearly something on which all the ministries are going to be working together so that we will, in a time-bound manner, adopt standards which are necessary. Technical standards which have to be put out also will be put out so that not just ensuring our exports are qualitatively superior, but this will be enough for us to stand up and check on what kind of imports are coming into this country. A working group, therefore, on standards will be set up again in the Department of Commerce to work with industry so that they can lay down a roadmap for adoption of standards, timelines, and enforcement. This is expected to be a big boost in enabling Indian products to overcome any non-tariff barriers, which are most often becoming a big headache for our exporters. So in order to meet every such non-tariff barrier with technical sound paperwork in our hand and established quality standards in our hand, we hope to make that difference to the exporters. Again, under this, affordable testing and certification infrastructure will be adequately expanded. There shall be enough money invested and developed with the PPP mode so that exporters get all internationally accepted tests and certification done within India. This is one of the, I would say, pet peeve of many of the exporters, that they spend huge amounts going here and there trying to test their products. But now this will reduce the cost of adoption of standards and also certification for Indian exporters so that they can meet global standards. The last silo in the measures for boosting exports is this one. Enable handicrafts industry to effectively harness e-commerce for exports. Here I would like to say a big word of appreciation for TRIFED, which till now probably was not even recognized as somebody who was doing very good work, but now they've made an extraordinary step in linking with e-commerce markets. As a result, they are finding newer sources of export. So special dispensation for facilitating and onboarding handicrafts artisans and handicraft cooperatives directly on the e-commerce portals and enable seamless exports. Mass enrollment will be undertaken for all artisans across India with help of the Ministry of Textiles and organizations like TRIFED, because textiles deals with handicrafts also. So mass enrollment of artisans across India with the help of Ministry of Textiles and organizations like TRIFED, CIE, and so on will be taken up so that handicraft promotion can happen. Now we move over to the housing sector. There's been a lot of consultation. Till now, the steps taken, a quick run through of what we've done till now. Affordable housing, you know, during the budget we had announced. Additional deduction of up to 1.5 lakhs for interest paid on loans borrowed up to 31st March 2020, part of my budget announcement, to purchase of house valued up to 45 lakhs. In fact, I'd like to report to you here, I've had quite a few housing finance corporation companies calling me to say, this particular scheme has had very good offtake. There is a lot of response. In fact, I wouldn't even name the officials who've spoken to me, but now it's out for all of us to even check up that this particular scheme for affordable housing has really taken off very well. And I'm glad for that, and I wish all institutions funding housing under the affordable housing scheme should move faster, because there is a lot of interest among buyers. Then banks to launch repo rate or external benchmark linked loans. I'm monitoring it very closely so that banks do follow this instruction which has come from the Reserve Bank. As I said, on the 19th, I'll be meeting with all the public sector bank heads. I'm sure to take it forward there. Then the support for the NBFCs and the HFCs. You're aware that more credit support has been extended, and additional liquidity support for the housing finance corporations, which was up to 20,000 crore till now by the NHB, has now increased to about 30,000 crores. The partial credit guarantee scheme for purchase of pooled assets is also moving, and from the banks further to the NBFCs. Once again, after my review with the bank chiefs on the 19th September, I shall come back to report on how much is moving on that. But that's also one of the things I'll be talking with them on the September 19th. Then the credit enhancement for infrastructure and housing projects organization shall be provided, and that was part of the announcement in the budget. Then debenture redemption reserve is a major thing, a requirement for creation of a debenture redemption reserve for outstanding debentures in respect of listed companies, NBFCs, and for HFCs have been removed. Then Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, particularly the Grameen, you know the numbers, 1.95 crores of people will be eligible beneficiaries with amenities like toilets, electricity, and LPG connections, all given during this phase ending 21-22. Within the next 2 years, this will be done. So what are we doing now? There shall be a relaxation of the ECB, the External Commercial Borrowing Guidelines, for affordable housing. So ECB guidelines will be relaxed to facilitate financing of home buyers who are eligible under the PMAY in consultation with RBI. So this is in addition to the existing norms for ECB for affordable housing. So external commercial borrowing guidelines are being relaxed. The next is house building advance. The interest rate on house building advance shall be lowered and linked with the 10-year G-Sec yields. So this will particularly benefit government servants who contribute to a major component of demand for houses. This will encourage more government servants to buy new houses. The next, a special window for affordable and middle income housing is being created. This is a very important feature of today's announcement, in that a special window will provide the last mile funding requirements for housing projects which are non-MPA and non-NCLT projects and are net worth positive in affordable and middle income category to be set up. This particular window, which will be set up with a fund size of 10,000 crores, which will be contributed by Government of India and roughly the same amount from outside investors. What we expect to do with this particular window is that this window or the special dispensation will be run by complete professionals. They shall be drawn from out the marketplace or experienced domain specialists who have either banking or housing finance related experience. They shall operate this window, and they in turn will be identifying all over the country such projects which are middle income and affordable schemes related, where nearly 60% of the work is completed and they don't have any more cash flow that they can complete the rest 40%. As a result, the middle income groups, affordable in houses buying groups, people who are waiting for their houses to be given to them but who invested and are waiting can now find relief, in that through this assistance, the project shall get completed. People don't have to live in a rented house, keep paying their monthly installments and also not get their house in hands. So for all over the country, wherever the housing projects are stuck because they are not complete, can now seek relief so long as they are not an NPA and not in the NCLT. So such middle income projects and also such affordable housing projects which are almost complete but are waiting for the last mile cash infusion shall benefit from this special window that we've created with a core of 10,000 crores of rupees. As I said, government is not going to operate it, but certainly will bring in professionals who will run this. And we expect, therefore, unfinished units will get completed. Government of India, on the lines of NIIF, the National Infrastructure Investment Fund, can contribute to the fund, while rest of the investors would be like LIC, other institutions and private capital from banks, sovereign funds and DFIs and so on. The fund shall be set up as a Category 2 AIF, Alternative Investment Fund Trust, and would be professionally run with experts from housing and banking sector. So that's about the housing sector. So broadly today we have touched on exports and also housing, other than also giving you a quick picture of what we've followed up on the last two announcements. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, we'll take the first question here from the front row itself. Yeah.
Ma'am, with the current set of measures that you've announced on housing and exports, what is the total outgo? Because in the first scheme of exporters, we saw that about 50,000 crores of a revenue outgo it will be. But overall for housing, and like you've also created a stress asset fund, how much outgo will it be? And what sort of a fillip are you seeing with this in the economy?
I've mentioned the numbers about what kind of investment, I mean, what kind of government money is going in and what is the revenue foregone. But the sectors are such. Sectors meaning the export sectors, and within the export area, we are touching on labor-intensive exporters and also giving a special dispensation for promotion of handicrafts. So we expect that it will immediately impact a lot of rural artisans and also small and medium units, which are on an export drive. So the also the ambiguity about the continuation of MEIS is cleared. We have given a better scheme which will now take care of the requirement of support which the exporters would have needed. And therefore, we expect that to immediately impact on all the SME exporters, those who belong to labor-intensive sectors. That is one. And second, on the housing, the way we have worked at the way we have worked out with the window that we've given, we expect all over the country, not just the NCR and Mumbai, all over the country, wherever people are waiting for their apartments or houses to be completed, which are half finished, and the builders or promoters are waiting for the last bit of finishing to be done for want of money and for want of banks extending that loan anymore, they are suffering. We have clearly said for all the non-NPA, non-NCLT cases, at least this window will give them the opportunity to complete the projects and clearly hand over the apartments or the flats to those middle-income people who are waiting for relief.
Since the fund is going to invest in those projects, how will the fund get back the money?
I can give you the details.
Will the fund get the ownership, or how will the fund get back its money, or what is the commercial interest of that fund to put in money in those projects?
Of course, the securities and other things will have to be taken on board. The rules and regulations will be released in a day or two. You'll get to seeing it. But the idea is, do you want to add something more?
See, whenever such funds are prepared, they would decide to either go by equity or superior debt or by pari passu debts. And subsequently, there is an ICA, inter-creditor agreement, which takes care of the interest of the existing creditors as well as those who are coming up new. See, the important part of this is that otherwise, wherever those projects perhaps are looking at completion, but for one reason or the other, they don't have that kind of a funding available, then the existing creditors also over a period of time tend to move into NPA and CLT kind of a category. Therefore, creditors are very keen that somebody comes in and brings that last mile funding. Therefore, ICA arrangement, and as I mentioned, that a melange of equity, superior debt, or a pari passu debt takes care of these kind of requirement of instruments which are very well known as FMS.
You will also announce the parameters on which the fund will choose to invest in the projects?
As the fund and the AMC is in place, they will announce.
Okay. Ma'am, all those measures are a welcome move, for the housing sector, this 10,000 crore will be applicable for, you said, non-NPA and non-NCLT. What about the projects which are already stuck, like most of the projects in Delhi NCR, they are already either in NCLT and or like, you know, NPA. So what will happen to those home buyers? Any thought for that?
If they are already in the NCLT, they will decide on how the whole thing will be resolved. That is why we are not picking up on those which are in the NCLT. If they are in the NCLT already, there is a process through which the NCLT will decide how to resolve those projects which are stuck.
But ma'am, that won't take care the problem of the home buyers, because most of the time these funds have been siphoned by the developers. So while your measure, I mean, they will take care of the future, a lot of future affordable housing project. But what about already so many housing projects which are stuck, like 5.3 lakh crore? It's not a
first
small
thing,
number.
Ma'am, first thing, the solution here offered are first of all for those projects which are also not complete, where people have put in their money, home buyers are waiting, who are waiting because the builders will have to complete and give them. So this solution addresses them. But for you, for the question that you're asking, you're already saying, what about those which are stuck in the NCLT? What about those which are stuck in the NPA? There are processes under the IBC, which have been explained earlier also, which take care of those which are NPAs, which have gone into resolution under the IBC, Insolvency Bankruptcy Code, and those which are already in the courts. Like, for instance, I'll take this opportunity to say that there is an interministerial group which is also looking at some of those projects which are stuck and which are probably going through the court also. And we are monitoring that. So this is clearly for those which are not being under NCLT or NPA. This category also throughout the country has a lot of home buyers waiting for some solution. We are offering them a solution. But those which are stuck under NCLT will get a resolution through the NCLT.
मैम मैं लक्ष्मण सीएनबीसी आवाज से मेरा सवाल यह है कि जो आपने 10,000 करोड़ रुपए अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग के लिए देने का फैसला लिया जो होम बायर्स उनको राहत पहुंचाने के लिए उसमें जो कंडीशन लगाया आपने
जस्ट वन मिनट आई एम बीइंग रिमाइंडेड बाय सेक्रेटरी होम बायर्स आर एनीवे ट्रीटेड इवन इफ दे आर अंडर द एनसीएलटी ट्रीटेड एज ऑपरेशनल क्रेडिटर्स सो दे हैव अ प्लेस इन द रेजोल्यूशन मैकेनिज्म
मैम जो आपने 10,000 करोड़ रुपए देने की जो शर्तें लगाई हैं जो नॉन एनपीए नॉन एनसीएलटी है तो क्या इसके पीछे कोई रिसर्च या कोई रिपोर्ट है कि ऐसे कितने प्रोजेक्ट हैं जो वाकई में 60% कंप्लीट हो चुके हैं नॉन एनपीए नॉन एनसीएलटी है चूँकि अधिकांश जैसा इन्होंने बताया एनसीएलटी में या तो एनपीए है तो इसे कितने बेनिफिशियरी होंगे कुछ आइडिया कुछ
रफली 3.5 lakhs
मैम दिस इज रुचि भाटिया Ma'am, this is Ruchi Bhatia from...
You will...
See, the numbers for this is roughly in the range of 3 to 3.5 lakhs all over the country. If you can even Google, you'll get the same data of the projects which are in the non-NPA, non-NCLT, all over the country. Of course, these are dynamic numbers, almost change on daily basis. How dwelling units, dwelling units.
Ma'am, this is Ruchi Bhatia from ET Now. Ma'am, I have two questions to ask of you. One of is, you are saying 10,000 crore rupees will be put in and additional will be coming in from other investors as well. Is that money be, will that money be enough to be able to complete units talking about? Secondly, ma'am, the present law says that one buyer can take a faulty builder to the NCLT. There were talks that the government may look at making revisions to this law and ensuring that 2/3 of the buyers can take a builder to NCLT. Are you looking at revising those laws as well?
Before I say yes, I'm looking at revising. There's a lot of discussion going on it. We'll see what is the outcome of it. There is a lot of discussion going on within the ministry about that.
Ma'am, this scheme on remission of duties or taxes on export products, just a clarification, this revenue foregone
just
figure
one,
of...
Sorry? Well, we have made a beginning. As it goes, we'll see how it pans out.
Ma'am, this scheme, RODDEP, the estimate by the government is that the revenue foregone is 50,000 crore. Just a clarification, ma'am, is that cumulative or is that per annum? 50,000 crore revenue
per annum. No?
Per annum.
Yes.
Is there a sunset clause to the scheme?
We have not thought of it as yet.
All right. Thank you, ma'am.
I have very clearly said that the MES and also the ROSL will continue only till 31st December. Post that, only ROD tech will continue.
In the new scheme.
The new scheme which is being proposed is and is a different scheme as compared to the MEIS. MEIS is not WTO compliant scheme. And the basis of the new scheme is refund of all such taxes and duties which are not yet refunded, like GST is refunded, customs duty is refunded. But this calculation will be made from sector to sector. It will be different. And what ma'am has, what finance minister has indicated is that the overall envelope for duty foregone under the new scheme will be more or less similar to the MEIS envelope, which at present is around 40,000, 45,000 crore as far as current year export is concerned. So broadly, it will be like that. Otherwise, MEIS scheme would have to be closed sometime if, because it is not WTO compliant. And then this is the scheme, refund of duties, which is WTO compliant, and it will go on, and it is their right. So that is the one. It is very difficult because the calculations will be made from sector to sector depending upon the duties and taxes which are being refunded.
You have said that there would be relaxation of external commercial borrowings for the housing sector. Does it mean that the people can go out to borrow externally, or does it allow or facilitate outside players to come into the sector for finance?
You see, it's very specific. Today also, all the banks are outside the ECM norms. They have the relaxation with respect to this sector. This particular initiative is meant for those HFCs or other organizations which are eligible to lend to home buyers. And the qualifying part would be those houses which qualify under the PMAY norm. That is the norm where income up to 18 lakhs roughly and houses up to 200 square meter. Today, the ECB norm limits only lending up to 60 square meter. So it enhances the limit of the range of housing as well as reduces the cost for HFCs. These are two specific features of this initiative.
Yeah, ma'am, Ritu Parna from CNBC this side. The new scheme that will replace the MEIS scheme, will it require cabinet approval and when will you get it? And secondly, the rates under which the new scheme will be given as far as product by product, the rates, by when that rates would be finalized, product by product, tariff line by tariff line?
As Finance Minister has already clarified, the new scheme, refund of duties or taxes, will be in operation from 1st January 2020. And before that, all these rates will be for different sector to sectors will be worked out and announced, and those, and then the MEIS in there in those sectors will not be there. So it will be worked out sector to sector, just like textile, it is already there in case of apparel and made up, and in other sectors it will be soon worked out. And as far as the issue of cabinet approval, yeah, that's right, and will be it is almost final and will be moving there.
Yes.
Ma'am, Sameer Dikshit hu. मैं फीडबैक लिहाज से आपसे समझ बीजेपी कैबिनेट पार्टी है आपको करो इकोनॉमिक पर किस तरीके का फीडबैक आपको किस तरीके का रिस्पांस स्वीकार करता हूं से क्या काम बोलते आपको मिल रहा है किस तरीके का रिस्पांस आपको
कौन
बता समीर दीक्षित जी चैनल से मैं अपना सवाल दोहरा देता हूं मैम बीजेपी कैडर बेस्ड पार्टी है लाखों करोड़ों कार्यकर्ता हैं तो इकोनॉमी के मुद्दे पर किस तरीके का फीडबैक किस तरीके का रिस्पांस आपको अपने कार्यकर्ताओं से मिल रहा है किस तरीके का जवाब उनसे मिल रहा है आपको ग्राउंड रिपोर्ट किस तरीके की मिल रही है
रिस्पांस ऐसे ही मिल रही है जिसके तहत हम हमारी तरफ से हर सेक्टर को जो इनपुट दे रहे हैं वो सब उन रिस्पांसों का नतीजा ही है सो द काइंड ऑफ रिस्पांस आई एम गेटिंग फ्रॉम द पार्टीज इंटरेक्शन इन द ग्राउंड is really the kind based on which our responses are being given here. So they're not widely different other than what I consult myself.
Ma'am, main Amir hoon. Sabse pehle to aapko Hindi Divas ki mubarakbad. Dusra sawal mera ye hai ki Delhi NCR mein kareeb 70,000 se zyada project, jo 70,000 se zyada flat phase hue hain, jisko sabse zyada zarurat thi is samay sarkar se rahat ki. आपने 10,000 करोड़ मदद की बात की फिर 10,000 करोड़ निवेशकों से मदद की बात होगी लेकिन क्या उन लोगों के लिए जो इंतजार कर रहे थे कि सरकार की तरफ से कोई बड़ा स्टेप लिया जाएगा ताकि उनको राहत मिल सके दिल्ली एनसीआर
हाँ दिल्ली एनसीआर में भी अगर ऐसे फ्लैट्स हैं जो इनकम्प्लीट है, जो एनपीए नहीं है, जो एनसीएलटी में गई नहीं है, उन सबको इससे राहत जरूर मिलेगा।
लेकिन मैडम कोई सर्वे किया गया कि ऐसे कितने
रफली द नंबर ऑफ ड्वेलिंग यूनिट्स का नंबर आपको बोला गया है उसको ऑल इंडिया, ऑफ कोर्स ऑल इंडिया, दिस इज हाउसिंग रिलेटेड इश्यूज आर नॉट जस्ट कन्फाइंड टू एनसीआर, हाउसिंग रिलेटेड प्रॉब्लम्स आर ऑल ओवर द कंट्री, वी हैव टू रेस्पॉन्ड फॉर एवरीबॉडी।
बॉम्बे अहमदाबाद में वो ऐसा कोई अलग सर्वे नहीं किया।
मैम सपना दास फ्रॉम सीएनबीसी टीवी 18 रिया मैम। Ma'am, I mean, I don't know whether this number is accurate, but I've heard that basically the overall number of dwelling units or flats stands around 14 lakh all over the country, you know, which have run into problem. So in case we are looking at 3.5 lakh houses, you know, which will benefit now, which have not been occupied so far, but the occupation will happen with the setting up of the fund, you will still have a very large majority, a very large mass, you know, that will not be impacted by today's announcement, you know, because of litigation or whatever. So down the line, would you be looking at anything in terms of your IBC laws or anything further that you would like to look at, ma'am? That's one question. And ma'am, second, you know, now and then we keep getting these comments from markets or whatever, like, is there a fiscal stimulus coming? Is there a fiscal stimulus coming? Would the government like to clarify on this also, ma'am?
First one, see, you didn't see the categorization by non-NPA, non-NCLT. A, the number of 14 lakh, in fact, the number as per the various statistics which stands today is close to 8.5. However, I'll not sort of argue on that. It's a very, one specific category that is non-NPA, non-NCLT. Therefore, that's a kind of a number which stands between 3 to 3.5 lakhs. So that's your first question. On the other part is, you have already asked about the legal part about IBC and all. FM has already mentioned a very important thing, that how home buyers are operational creditor in the scheme of things in the waterfall mechanism. Kindly appreciate that part. And that's where they tend to gain. Over and above, where there are cases which tend to be more ticklish, go beyond IBC issues also, FM herself, along with other stakeholders, has been holding consultations to ensure that if the problems are beyond the sort of given kind of a structure, they can also be resolved.
Also, yes, we'll take it.
Ma'am.
Question on fiscal stimulus was not a question. Wait a minute, I heard you. You conveyed a certain feeling which is prevailing outside. I've heard you. Fine.
मैम मोनिका यादव जी बिजनेस से। मैम मेरा क्वेश्चन है कि ग्लोबल स्लोडाउन के चलते ये एक्सपोर्ट मेजर्स कितने इफेक्टिव हैं, और सितंबर 19 को जो पीएसबीज के साथ आपकी मीटिंग है उसमें आपका मेन फोकस क्या होगा?
सितंबर 19 का मेरा मीटिंग पीएसबी के साथ, मैंने जैसे मेरा प्रेजेंटेशन चलते आई एक्सप्लेन टू यू कौन कौन से ऐसे मुद्दे के ऊपर उनके साथ बात करूँगी। जैसे आई हैव सेड दैट द फ्लो ऑफ लिक्विडिटी शुड ऑल्सो बी समथिंग ऑन विच आई वॉन्ट टू, पार्शियल गारंटी स्कीम विच वी हैव गिवन, वी विल बी आस्किंग क्वेश्चंस ऑन हाउ फार दे आर एबल टू मूव ऑन दैट। ऑन द एक्सटर्नल बेंच मार्क रिलेटेड और रिपो रेट रिलेटेड मैटर we will be talking to them. Those are the mudda on which I'll be talking with the public sector banks.
Okay, we'll take question.
Ma'am, I'm Nikunj Ohri from Bloomberg Quint. First, a clarification, what happens to the SEIS scheme, which is for logistic companies, that was set to expire on, ends by FY20. And my question to you is, what is the government planning to do to boost consumption in the economy? What are the measures that the government plans to take? There was a report, And there was a report submitted by the task force to review direct tax laws. So that committee has recommended rationalizing income tax rate for individuals. So when does the government plan to implement those changes? Because that's going to give more money in the hands of individuals to spend more in the economy.
Talk on the SEIS.
As far as SEIS scheme is concerned, it is not that it is over. The rates for the current years are being announced, which will be really given generally in the case of SEIS, which is Services Exports from India scheme. There, one-time applications are asked at the end of the financial year for, because it's on the net foreign exchange basis. So the rates for the current year exports are being just finalized. We are just consulting. We are just restructuring the SEIS scheme so that only those sectors which are really required to be incentivized, they are given, and they will be announced within a fortnight or so. And it will be continued.
Yes. Ma'am, Sunil Prabhu, NDTV. Just...
One minute. You asked out the income tax, direct taxation committee. Yes, they have submitted the report and we are going through it. Let's see. I'll let you know the moment we take a call on it.
Ma'am, Sunil Prabhu, NDTV, just, you know, you've been announcing for the last 2-3 weeks, a lot of steps, and I go back to the first press conference that you said, really, which is about fiscal deficit. Now that the growth has gone down in the first quarter, You've been listening to a lot of people trying to take steps. Do you believe you'll be able to meet your fiscal deficit target, one? And second, do you expect growth to, increase in the next quarter? Or where do you see it overall in this financial year?
Well, every attempt that is being made in the consultation and also in responding to the consultations like we are doing today is with an expectation that it will bring a difference at the ground level. And is also with an expectation that at least in the next quarter we'll see the numbers improve. So it is with that positivity that we're moving forward.
You want to put a figure to
it? Not yet.
And fiscal deficit, will you keep that target? That's the real...
I've mentioned it in the budget.
Ma'am, Vanakkam, Venkatraman from Dinamalar, ma'am. Ma'am, Venkatraman, Dinamalar. பல்வேறு ஏற்றுமதி அதிகரிக்கும் வகையில் நீங்கள் பல்வேறு நடவடிக்கைகள் இப்போ வந்து ஒவ்வொன்றா நீங்கள் சொன்னீங்க. அதில் குறிப்பாக வந்து அடுத்த ஆண்டு மார்ச் மாதம் 20th 20th ஆன்யுவல் ஷாப்பிங் ஃபெஸ்டிவல் ஒன்று நடத்த போகிறதா ஒன்று இருக்கீங்க. அது வந்து தமிழகத்துக்கு
என்ன பண்ணணுங்க? அது டிசைட் பண்ணுறவங்க டிசைட் பண்ணுவாங்க. காமர்ஸ் மினிஸ்ட்ரியில் இருக்காங்க, அவங்க தான் டிசைட் பண்ணுவோம். 4 இடத்துல நான் தமிழ்நாட்டிலேயே ஒரு இடம் இருக்கா இல்லையான்றது அவங்க நிர்ணயிக்கணும். நான் பண்ண முடியாது. த க்வெஸ்டன் தட் வாஸ் ஆஸ்ட் இஸ் தேவர் 4 different பிளேசஸ் தட் வி செட் திஸ் ஷாப்பிங் வில் ஹேப்பன் லைக் த வே இட் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் இன் துபாய். ஸோ மிஸ்டர் வெங்கட்ராமன்ஸ் க்வெஸ்டன் வாஸ் வில் தமிழ்நாடு கெட் ஒன் ஆஃப் தென். ஸோ ஐ செட் காமர்ஸ் மினிஸ்ட்ரி வில் டிசைட் ஆஸ் டு வே தே வாண்ட்.
Yes.
Ma'am, this is Aishwarya Paliwal from India Today. Ma'am, for some time the government was saying that they believe in making structural reforms which would help the economy in the longer run and not giving out doles. Today itself, close to 80,000 crore rupees in both exports and housing has been given out. So do you think this is what is required going ahead, both structural reforms as well as putting in more money in different sectors?
Well, I like the way you've asked this question. What is important at this juncture is to bring in clarity so that export-oriented industries, particularly the SMEs, do not get affected. There was definitely this ambiguity as regards the continuation of MEIS. But there was also very clearly, because of the WTO-related issues on the MEIS, there was an issue of whether to continue it in that model or not. But sum and substance of that discussion is our export industries require hand-holding. Sum and substance of it is because of the global headwinds about exports, these SMEs, which are largely dependent and they do very well in exports, needed that kind of a support. And that is if we were to do it in to be in compatible mode with the WTO, we designed this so that the rebate can provide on the duties and the taxes which are levied on them. And to that extent, and that is why when this question was asked from before me about can you tell us what in addition to MEIS this will mean, the specific amount can't be said because it will be actuals of the taxes and the rebates on a particular item, and that has to be worked out by the DGFT, and only then can I give you. So this question which was asked from here saying, tell us what is going to be the addition over and above MEIS, cannot be said like that because MEIS went on a percentage. It said 2% here, 5% there. So you were able to get a total. Whereas what this RO DTP TEP does is to actually calculate the exact amounts of the tax and the rebate. So I won't be able to say which is the exact amount that we are going to be giving out. So the dole that you're referring to is not really a dole. It is more a support in cutting down on the taxes and the duties that they end up paying when you're exporting. Taxes and duties cannot be exported. So we withdraw that component by giving the rebate. That's the philosophy behind it. So that's where I have a little problem about using the word dole. They are not really dole. They're actually helping exports.
Ma'am,
and structural measures, yes, we will continue doing structural reforms, and that process will be an ongoing process, keeping in mind the long-term gains.
Yeah. Ma'am, mera naam Manish hai, News 24 se. Is taraf, ma'am. Yeah. मैम आपने प्रेजेंटेशन में अपने पहले जो दो तीन स्लाइड्स आपने दिखाया उसमें कहा कि इंडस्ट्रियल प्रोडक्शन रिवाइव हो रहा जो आंकड़े बता रहे हैं पहली तिमाही के क्या आप ये संदेश देना चाहती हैं कि अर्थव्यवस्था में जिस तरीके की बातें बताई जा रही है कि संकट के दौर से गुजर रहा मंदी के दौर से गुजर रहा पूर्व प्रधानमंत्री कह रहे हैं कि सरकार जो है उसके कारण जो है ये डिजास्टर देखा जा रहा है तो आप क्या कहना चाहते हैं कि अर्थव्यवस्था पटरी पर लौट रहा है क्या संदेश देना चाहती हैं इसके जरिए
नहीं संदेश के विषय नहीं है जी मैं एक्चुअली फैक्ट्स आपके सामने रख रही हूँ और ये भी बोल रही हूँ कि सेक्टर के मुताबिक हर सेक्टर से बात करके जिन जिन सेक्टर में चैलेंजेस हैं उनके जो भी इच्छा है उसकी सरकार से मदद ऐसे ऐसे चाहिए उनको हम रिस्पॉन्ड कर रहे हैं मैं ऐसे संदेश कुछ नहीं दे रही हूँ मैटर ऑफ फैक्ट बात बोल रही हूँ कि सरकार क्या कर रही है
ऑलमोस्ट मिलता जुलता सवाल था अर्थव्यवस्था जिस समय से गुजर रही है उसके लिए कोई मंदी बोल रहा है कोई स्लोडाउन बोल रहा है कोई टफ दिन बोल रहा है तो आप इसे क्या नाम दे रही हैं या देती हैं और कब तक ये फेस चलेगा
मैं कोई नाम देने के लिए नहीं हूं इधर मैं काम करने के लिए हूं जी
मैम कैन यू थ्रो अ लिटिल बिट मोर लाइट ऑन द डॉलर क्रेडिट दैट यू आर प्रपोजिंग टू गिव टू एक्सपोर्टर्स एट चीपर रेट्स हाउ इट विल बी इम्प्लीमेंटेड एंड एट व्हाट रेट्स विल दे बी गेट यस यस मैम न्यूज की
Could I ask?
The number one scheme which FM has mentioned is the increased ECGC coverage. At present, the banks who provide export credit to exporters, they are insured by the ECGC to the extent of 60%. This ECGC scheme is for increasing that coverage, that insurance coverage, to 90%, especially for the MSME sectors. What this will do is, this will provide comfort to the bankers to give more loan because this kind of loan becomes enhanced in the sense that they become credit worthy, and this will increase the expansion of credit to the MSME sectors. So this is very important at present. As you are aware that credit flow to the exporters has come down to the extent of about 35%. So that will increase, expansion will increase, and bankers will be much more comfortable in providing ESCO. And yes. As per our calculation, this will, the expected export to grow in crore is the first year will be about 4,048 crores, second year it will be about 5,038 crores of credit, export credit, which will be given by the banks. So that's the main thing. And the interest rate is expected. We have discussion with the bankers. The interest rate is likely to be below 8% in case of INR credit. And similarly, in case of Forex credit, it will be sub 4%. So that is the kind of thing which the exporters will be able to get.
मैम हाउसिंग में आपने बताया जो 3.5 लाख आज जो स्टेप लिए गए हैं उससे उन प्रोजेक्ट्स को पूरा करने में मदद मिलेगी जो बाकी के लगभग 8.5 लाख जैसे सर बता रहे थे प्रोजेक्ट पेंडिंग है क्या उनके लिए आने वाले दिनों में हम उम्मीद करें कि सरकार फिर से कोई एक लेके आएगी
मैम
See, these are the houses, A, which are non-NPA, non-LCT, and we appreciate that, and also the houses which are in the middle income and affordable housing category. You must appreciate where the initiative is going to be. There are a large number of houses which are in IBC, and there are a large number of houses which are actually under construction and going on. So those are the houses which get constructed and get over. These are the houses which require last mile interventions. So that's a number for which an assessment has been placed. What actually comes for subsequent funding would be depending upon who actually make a demand on the last mile funding. It's very difficult to assess that.
Ma'am,
sir.
How?
And why did the finance ministry opt for a this is Srivats from Business Line. Why did the finance ministry opt for a AIF 2 category fund for the affordable housing fund? Is there a particular advantage that you get out of it? And you said it will be patterned on NIIF. So will you look at bringing other sovereign wealth funds into this fund?
See, these are classically category 2 AIFs. That's the category in which these kind of a structure tend to fall into. Those who will make the funding, well, it is open. If sovereign funds would come into it, they would also participate. So it's a trust in which those who are eligible to come in will come.
Sir. मैं प्रशांत हूं एबीपी न्यूज़ से जो अधूरे पड़े मकानों को जो पूरा करने का प्रोजेक्ट है उससे नंबर चाहे जो भी हो कितने लोगों को फायदा होगा अगर मैं एक होम बायर हूं मैं एक छोटा सी बात जानना चाहता हूं तो मुझे कैसे पता चलेगा कि मैं इस स्कीम में आ रहा हूं या नहीं कोई डेटाबेस है आपके पास या किसी तरीके से अगर मैं एक होम बायर हूं तो कैसे मुझे पता चलेगा
No way of suggesting that who will get in and who will not get in. What has been defined as the category of projects, wo projects unki category kya hai jo ki qualifying honge. Uske baad kaun sa project apply karega, us yojana ka laab uthana chahega, wo jaise scheme aage chalti hai, to usme pata chalta hai.
Uska dusra answer bhi ye hai, ki aap agar ek home buyer hai, आप जा करके आपके बिल्डर से ये पूछ ले सकते हैं कि क्या एनसीएलटी में हो या एनपीओ हो अगर दोनों नहीं है प्लीज अप्रोच करो इसको हमें फायदा उठाओ इसके लिए कंप्लीट करके हमें घर दो यू कैन इवन डू दैट सो इफ योर बायर इज नॉट अंडर एनसीएलटी एंड नॉट एन एनपीए ही इज वेलकम टू अप्रोच दिस इंस्टीट्यूशन द प्रोफेशनल्स विल डिसाइड द फॉर्मुलेशन एंड दे विल गिव द असिस्टेंस जो एनसीएलटी में है और जो एनसीएलटी क्या मतलब इट्स अ ट्राइब्यूनल उनका प्रोसेस है उस प्रोसेस के तहत होम बायर्स को एक मिनट सुन लीजिए ना प्लीज उस प्रोसेस के तहत होम बायर्स को ऑपरेशनल क्रेडिटर के नाते उनका भी हक बनता है जब रेसोल्यूशन एनसीएलटी तय करते हैं उसमें होम बायर्स का भी एक स्थान है उनको उससे राहत मिलेगा मगर वो एनसीएलटी के द्वारा क्योंकि वो ऑलरेडी एनसीएलटी में है हम उसको अकेला हटकर निकाल करके इस स्कीम में डाला नहीं जाते वी कांट डाल नहीं सकते हैं सिमिलरली आईबीसी के तहत कोर्ट में जो है या बैंक में ऑलरेडी एनपीए हो चुके हैं इसीलिए वो एनसीएलटी में आएगा या आईबीसी में जाएगा आईबीसी में भी ये वाटरफॉल मैकेनिज्म है जब रेसोल्यूशन का फॉर्मुलेशन आते हैं उस फॉर्मुलेशन में होम बायर को ऑपरेशनल क्रेडिटर के तहत उनको हक है और उनका राहत मिलेगा जो भी राहत तय होते हैं उधर उसके अनुसार मिलेगा उन दोनों को इसीलिए हम इसमें नहीं जोड़ रहे हैं इसलिए कि ऑलरेडी एक रेसोल्यूशन सिस्टम में वो घुस गए हैं उसको बाहर निकाल करके इसमें डालना मुश्किल है इसीलिए बाकी जो वेट कर रहे हैं जो एनसीएलटी में नहीं है एनपीए नहीं है उनको कम से कम राहत दिलाएं इसीलिए इस रास्ते पे चल रहे
मैम दिस इज दीपशिखा फ्रॉम इकोनॉमिक टाइम्स
Your budget assumptions were made with a 11% nominal GDP growth.
Sorry,
and if you
repeat it,
your budget assumptions were made on a nominal GDP growth of 11%. The first quarter numbers show that, you know, it's fallen to 8%. So are you reassessing your fiscal maths, or do you see it just as a blip, one quarter blip?
Well, it is a one quarter matter, but then we will definitely take that on board and reconcile it with what I've stated in the budget. I did state 11, and for the next year I said 11.6. So I'm conscious of that. But the nominal number now being very different from what we have said in the budget, we'll certainly reconcile that to what has been stated earlier and take a call on at what stage we are and what level we are.
Okay, last two questions.
Yeah. Hi, ma'am. I'm Danish Anand from Z Business. Today, you have exports ko boost karne measures announced. If we talk about global scenario, there is a slowdown chal raha hai, and then on the other hand, US ke saath bhi, we have a lot of trade tensions. So, do you think that the measures announced are going to cross all these obstacles? What was the first
obstacle?
Global slowdown.
Global slowdown, mein rupee ke value itna लो होने के बावजूद भी मतलब डॉलर के मुताबिक एक्सपोर्ट्स जो एक्चुअली उसके कारण और बढ़ना चाहिए उसको अगर हम प्रोत्साहन दे सकते हैं अभी उस प्रोत्साहन से क्या उनका परफॉर्मेंस बेटर होगा इस उम्मीद से ही ये एक्सटेंशन हो रही है ऐसे बेनिफिट्स क्या पूरे वो यूएस चाइना टेंशन को या ऐसे कुछ चैलेंजेस को मीट कर पाएंगे ये सिर्फ हमारे हेल्प के साथ नहीं कॉस्ट कॉम्पिटिटिवनेस और उनके क्वालिटी ऑफ प्रोडक्ट्स के साथ हमारे एक्सपोर्टर्स आज तक बहुत अच्छा करते आ रहे हैं उनका ये थोड़ा सा मदद भी उपयोग में आएगा ये हमारे एक्सपेक्टेशन है क्योंकि एज इट इज हमारे एक्सपोर्टर्स बहुत सारे विषय में अच्छा फेस कर रहे हैं ग्लोबल चैलेंजेस को हम इसके साथ उनको थोड़ा और राहत दिलाने के लिए कोशिश कर रहे हैं
लास्ट क्वेश्चन
मिनिस्टर आई एम सिद्धार्थ फ्रॉम ब्लूमबर्ग न्यूज आई वॉन्टेड टू आस्क यू ऑन द रेवेन्यू फोरगॉन बाय your announcements, the three announcements that you made, how will you bridge that revenue foregone? And are you still confident of meeting your fiscal deficit target? And the second question was on the outlook that IMF yesterday said that India's slowdown is much deeper than what it looks. So how do you see that? And the third question was on the slides that you showed on macroeconomic indicators. So did you purposefully miss out the GDP slide? Because there is no uptick there.
No, I don't think I purposely missed out. You're conscious of it and all of us are equally conscious. I don't mind showing if there is that's going to satisfy anybody. It is no missing out. That's a fact which is quite factually staring before us. Nobody can ever... Sorry? I've not been accepting that. That's government data. That's a government data. What do you want me to do? I said I will work, and just because I've not said any name from my side, government 5% is not something which I'm ignoring. Thank you. Sorry? What were the other two questions? Would you please repeat it? The other two, four. The question, just as you asked me about the GDP on the IMF also, it's all out for all of us to see and it's out also for me to see it. On the, yes, I'm coming to it. Shall I? On the fiscal deficit, I've already said that the numbers were given during the budget. I'm conscious of it and I'll make sure that I'm going to be able to do as much as possible to be able to stick to the number. Anything else?
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, ma'am.